Hey, everybody. Gary Pierce here, ham radio call sign KN4AQ, and I'm busting in here on the Ham Radio Now channel and whatever other channel I can get to post this video to ask for your help, your financial help, for my friend Jeff Wittich. For ham radio people, Jeff is AC4ZO. And I say my friend, but I think many of you also know Jeff either personally or from his many appearances with me on my Ham Radio Now podcast and TV show. Yeah, that's Jeff right there. Last year, Jeff was diagnosed with grade 4 glioblastoma. That is brain cancer. That is very bad brain cancer. Inoperable brain cancer. It's death sentence brain cancer. Now, I say inoperable. A better word would be incurable, because Jeff did have brain surgery last December, and he's just finished up a month-long course of radiation and chemotherapy. That's all just to extend his life and his quality of life for maybe a couple of years. Nobody really knows. We have averages. Dr. Google will tell you the average is about 2 years. There's a lot I could say about this, but I'm really making this video to ask you to help Jeff and his wife Bobbie with the expenses they're facing. They set up a GoFundMe. And then I'm going to show you Jeff's legacy in video, clips from the dozens of programs that Jeff helped me produce over the past 20 years. This is the GoFundMe. The goal is $25,000, and it's doing pretty well as of today, March 13th, as I record this. But it's got a long ways to go. Jeff tells you his current story. In case you can't find the link handy, the web address is gofundme.com/f/letspayitforwardforbobbie. And Bobbie is spelled B-O-B-B-I-E. And there are dashes between all those words. So it's let's-pay-it-. Yeah, you get the idea. Thanks in advance for that. And now the video. I met Jeff sometime in the mid-90s. He was a brand new ham radio operator, and we became friends pretty quickly when he joined the local radio club. I was pretty new to that club myself. I'd moved to town, that's Raleigh, North Carolina, in 1990. So Jeff was a new ham, and I was, what, an old ham? I was only in my 40s, but I'd been in ham radio for 30 years. So that made me an old-timer. And I'd been making videos for this radio club because... well, because I could. I had the technology at my disposal. My career was in television production. And remember, this was the mid-90s. Not everybody had a television production company in their pocket. Nobody did back then. Everybody does now. So I saw some raw talent in my new friend. Jeff was an engineer, not a media guy. But when I asked him to help me with a few video projects, he was happy to do it. He is that kind of friend. You ask him to do something that's basically a pain in the ass to him, and he jumps in and does it without complaint. Okay, maybe a little complaint, but you know, sometimes. But he does it. Toward the end of the decade, we'd started teaching our radio club's class for new hams. Getting a ham license isn't hard, but there's some learning involved, and we had fun teaching it. But we had one problem, and that's where this first video comes in.
Normally what we do when we teach this class is we begin with a demonstration, but my friend Jeff is supposed to bring the equipment, and I heard him on the radio earlier, but he's not here, and I'm not sure where he is. So I guess what we'll do is we'll just switch things around. Oh, there he is. Jeff!
Oh, hi, Gary. I'm sorry, I was just listening to 20 meters. Oh, hey, everybody. I didn't see you there.
Jeff, the class is tonight. You're supposed to be here.
I know, but I thought it would be easier to demonstrate some of ham radio from my shack here at home. Hey, why don't you bring everybody over and we'll give them a good demonstration.
I'll get my handy-talkie and I'll call you on the repeater. Okay?
Okay, I'll dial it in.
That video goes on to do our demo. In my car, my mobile, and at Jeff's house, his ham shack. And you can watch the whole thing on YouTube. It's titled Introduction to Amateur Radio 1999. And it's gotten about 38,000 views. In fact, I've put together a YouTube playlist for all the videos that you're going to see snippets from in this show. It's on the Ham Radio Now YouTube channel, and it's called AC4ZO on Ham Radio Now. Our next collaboration came in 2007. I'd started a little ham radio-based production company that I called ARVN, Amateur Radio Video News, and I know that's a terrible name. One of my first projects was going to be a video tour of the largest ham radio convention in the world, the Dayton Hamvention. I was going to be mostly behind the camera, so I needed a star. And of course, I asked Jeff. He'd never been to this giant ham radio show, so I presented it as a tour through the eyes of a first-timer, a Dayton virgin.
Do you have any first impressions?
Well, it doesn't look like HamFest I'm used to, that's for sure. So how much is this?
That's a dollar.
Oh, how much is that?
Oh, this is only a dollar.
How much is that?
Everything's a dollar.
My feet hurt. It's really very large. It's everything I'd always heard it was. And even now, what I've always heard is tough to imagine. It surpasses it.
I distributed that program on DVD, and I think I sold a few hundred, maybe enough to pay for the trip. Jeff and I returned to Dayton a few more times, and he helped me produce a few more shows on DVD. And then in 2012, I pivoted my little production company to make something called podcasts. I changed the name to Ham Radio Now, and I put the video on this fairly new thing called YouTube. It wasn't long before I dragged Jeff back before the camera.
I have no idea what we're doing.
Just follow my lead.
Mm-hmm.
Look who I found. It's the Dayton virgin, Jeff Wittich, AC4ZO, my video partner. I'm so happy to have
you
here.
That was years ago. Am I never going to live it down?
No, you're not. All right, I'm going to get out of here and just play a long string of clips featuring Jeff on my Ham Radio Now show. I produced about 400 episodes of that show. Jeff appears in about 43 of them. I would have had him in more, but he was working full-time, a lot of it on the road, so he joined me when he could. I think you'll agree that I did find that raw talent. Jeff never became Mr. Showbiz. He didn't need to. You wouldn't have wanted him to. He just played himself, and that was enough. And if you can kick in a few bucks to the GoFundMe, that'd be great.
And we are live at the Dayton Hamvention.
We are not live. We'll be lucky to see any of this video before New Year's.
Joining me here in this new palatial space is Jeff, AC4ZO, the Dayton virgin.
Yep, that's me.
So the GOTA station is, take it away, Jeff.
Get on the air. It's a station that's not necessarily a replacement from the novice station that we used years ago, but it's a means of introducing ham radio to people that may not be familiar with ham radio, or providing experience on HF to new hams, or maybe even a refresher for hams that have been inactive for a number of years.
Did we go into record?
It's coming. Oh, that I can't see. Yes.
We did. We went into record. The remote record unit worked.
Yeah, we're just getting ready to get started here. There will be the radio itself here needs a couple of connections to it. The tuner is in place, and it has got to be connected up to the radio, but we've got to do some work on the antenna first. It's not the field day operation that's the problem. It's all the little complications that come up when you're trying to do that. Things you left at home and I don't know what all.
Yeah.
We're here with Joe Fairclough, WB2JKJ, and you probably are familiar with that call sign because it's been in QST every month for years and
32
CQ
years.
And 32 years.
We sent up a bunch of crickets. We called them cricket knots.
Was there some knowledge that they could survive harsh conditions, or was it just on a whim?
It was based on a rumor that crickets could hold their breath for 2 hours.
The average ham isn't technical. It seems like is no longer technical enough to make use of a custom-made transformer and wouldn't know where to begin to spec out a transformer.
Go ahead and butter Charlie up and tell him what you think of this one.
Well, Gary doesn't know what I'm going to say because we hadn't discussed it, but I thoroughly enjoyed myself here. I would enjoy HamFest a lot more if I didn't have to work at them. But
I'm the one making him work.
Yeah, I get you. I
couldn't afford to come otherwise, no matter what your ticket prices
yeah,
are.
I hear you.
But I really enjoyed myself. It's nice to come to a ham fest and not see dealers grumbling.
Sorry.
We're going to do some stuff.
Look who's here.
It's about time you do some stuff on the show.
I'm not a corporate kind of guy. I don't know if you're a very corporate person. I resist the corporate thing.
No, I'm more of a ham person. I'm trying to think of how the Coke Museum deals with ham radio, but I'm a ham and I drink Diet Coke.
The Coke Museum has got nothing to do with ham radio. Aren't you going to complain about 73s?
Well, no. I've learned as I've gotten like really old that popularity makes correctness. It's something that no physicist could possibly understand, but humanitarian types can understand it. If you want to get along in the world, sometimes you just have to accept things based on popularity. The New Year's parties of 1999 were the perfect example. You know, the millennium started on New Year's Day 2001. But the big party was December 31st, 1999.
Well, that's because of that Prince song, going to party like it's 1999. Thank you, Jeff. Thanks for coming back. It's been a while since I've had you on the show.
Thanks for having me. It's been long now.
Back again soon. You're very popular out there. People like to watch you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, I don't know what
we're
doing.
I'll just sit up tall. You never know what we're doing. Well, this is Ham Radio Now. Remember the name of the program? Ham Radio
Now.
Do you know what this is? This momentous occasion. I know you don't know anything.
This is going on. It's an anniversary.
It is.
You didn't think I knew.
Of what?
Of the show.
That's right.
The podcast.
That's right.
Yeah.
We started Ham Radio Now 1 year ago.
Let me tell you how I knew that.
Because I made you watch episode one as we were driving down.
Yeah.
So that you can see what Orlando was all about.
Right. Now, see, I'm in serious danger of becoming political here.
Okay, go ahead.
No, let's move on.
It could get interesting, but it's not ham radio, is it?
Well, I was going to say, okay, you like CNN if you're a bleeding heart do-gooder.
Yeah. There you go. That's Jeff.
We're live at the Orlando Ham Kitchen.
We're live now, but by the time the viewers see it, it won't be. First, let's take a look at the frequency display here and how you switch frequencies.
Okay.
It's just... It looks pretty typical, like any other HF rig, but your higher rate is to just touch the kilohertz. There we go. And it switches at this rate.
You have an issue with band scopes, but only during contests like field day and new operators.
I have an issue with band scopes with new operators, and especially at field day, and I think they need to be turned off or covered up, because I have seen so many new operators bypass lots of workable signals to get to the one they can see that may not even be workable.
You feel uncomfortable with interviews?
I'm Mike Shy.
What's this?
I'm Mike.
Talking into it just fine.
I didn't say I can't do it or won't do it. I'm just not comfortable doing it.
You feel queasy in your stomach every minute I've got you on mic? I didn't know that about you.
Not as bad as that.
Jeff.
Hey.
You have a guest.
Okay, let's see who's here. He's brought telegraph keys, so I know I like him. You know, you're dealing with different groups of people. People that participate in an MCOM and so forth are not the ones that tend to argue whether or not a link on the internet is real ham radio.
Yeah, that's true.
You're going to find that from people that sit home on single sideband nets and nothing more.
and lurk on QRZ waiting
single
to
talk. Single sideband? That's not real ham radio.
See, and I wondered when you were explaining the evolutionary steps why you stopped right before that one. I guess because that's the one where hams are still alive.
But I hope that you would not consider a 33-year-old to be an old timer.
Well, you know, you'd have to go in context of what they do and how they are and not their age in that case.
Well, yeah, right. We're all
Does he
children.
Operate CW?
He operates digital.
Oh, well, he can't. I'm sorry, he just can't.
So a fellow walks up to the booth.
Oh, this will be a good one.
A priest, a rabbi. I want more of this to happen. A fellow walks up to the booth
and
says, I've got a story I think you guys are going to be interested in.
Okay.
He said three letters that said, okay, sit down here and talk. E-M-E.
E-M-E.
E-M-E. Jeff, you look like you got a question.
Well, just thinking about it with
climb up on that mic, Jeff.
With a megawatt ERP, that's a loss of, and I was trying to calculate what it was. What comes back is .001%.
Right.
Or .0008%.
Yep.
If my morning calculation worked.
I tend to ask questions fast, and I run roughshod over Jeff, but there must be something bubbling through your brain you'd like to discuss.
I'm a new ham, you know. I just need to listen and absorb, but I do have a question. My interest is a lot in the equipment because I like all the gadgets with the knobs and stuff. When you have the Alt-As rotor, does that come with the satellite tracking software, or do you have to have your own?
There are a number of different programs you can buy. I think there's even a couple of shareware programs, and they just know, if you tell it what rotator it is, they know how to talk to the rotator.
Okay.
That's it? That's the only thing you come up with to ask about? All right. Well, Pete, thank you very much for walking up to the booth.
Ham Radio Now from Orlando.
Did you forget where we were?
I did. We swapped interviewing positions. Jeff is going to take the lead here, so it's all yours.
Oh, okay, okay.
It's like those old stories where a youngster in a neighborhood would discover there's a ham in the neighborhood, and they kind of wheedle their way in to sit at that ham's elbow as he operates, and slowly the old curmudgeon ham brings the young fellow into the fold.
Well, you know, the first part of that story was me, but the second part never did happen.
It's when you were a kid?
Yeah, when I was a kid. Two things would bring kids out of the house. The sound of radios, of course, you almost never heard that, and the sound of these little model airplane engines, which you could hear for a really long way. So when they come to visit the Science Center, they have a lot of things competing for their attention at the Science Center. You have just a limited time to talk to them. Do you get a broad age range? Are they you know, fourth and fifth graders as well as ninth and tenth?
We get a broad age range.
Thanks, okay, Tom. That was really good.
Push stop on there. Stop those tapes.
Stop or the red button?
Same button. Same red button. Yeah. It's a toggle. Yeah, that one started up there. Ham Radio Now from Orlando. I kept saying Huntsville before.
Well, that's because that was the first time you actually had a studio in the booth.
Okay, Jerry, see you on 10 meters. Thanks a
Hopefully.
Lot. Ham Radio Now from
Orlando.
I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.
Ham Radio Now. I'm Jeff, AC4ZO, and we're at the Orlando Hamcation. We're here with Peter Eggemann, and you may remember we talked to Peter in Huntsville last year, and I just wanted to get an update on how things have been going for him. His daughter, Michelle, has told me that he's having a little bit of a situation concerning ham specking out transformers, and I wanted to get some detail on that, but first, there's a little bit of gossip going on.
Your camera makes me look fat.
Camera's making you look fat?
Yeah, I don't remember that, but let's not make too much of my memory, which incidentally is very good. It's just very short.
Yeah, so it's solid for a few seconds. They're amateur pitchmen.
Yeah, and they're in that mode. When they arrive at Dayton, they're in pitch mode.
Yeah.
And it's difficult to get any information that's not already canned in that pitch, but we'll see what we can do. Maybe there will be things going on outside. The balloon launch a couple years ago was pretty neat.
Sad to say, is still sitting on my shelf as a raw tape, unedited.
Oh, I forgot we shot that.
Yeah,
you
we did.
You shot that.
Yeah, but never edited it, never put it on.
Well,
lots of
that
other people
sort of
did,
thing.
Though.
You know, it's fun to watch hams doing ham stuff.
It is. Yeah, and we'll try to get that sort of stuff. And I've been better at editing things.
Well, with the SIB has helped with the editing quite a bit, hasn't it?
Yeah.
And it allows you to get to some of this older, valuable footage.
That's good. Jeff, the
of
famous Jeff.
World famous. It's like being with celebrities. Very cool.
Listen
All right.
to this. All right, so we've been here less than a day.
Somebody's taken our
and
picture.
Found a subscriber.
And somebody took our picture, and away we go.
All right, off we go.
You've got something here that's attracting a lot of attention, something with a crank on it that just about everybody that passes by gets hold of and gives it a spin. What he's going to demonstrate here is a coated ring. What would happen is 8 or 10 people would all be connected to the same phone line, and so when it rang, how would you know who the call was for? Well, the phone would ring in various patterns, and his pattern at his home was 2 longs and a short, was it? So here's what that would have sounded like.
They all sounded the same to me.
And I saw you hold it on its side, and it still runs.
It still runs.
Let's see that.
You close the door, and the light stays on.
The fact that it operates in any position is over the top. But
Finding bugs that can operate slow, like Nava speed slow, is practically impossible. The only ones I've ever seen that can do that was a very popular Skillman bug that was imported from Japan through the 60s by the tens of thousands, and they would slow down almost that slow, but they wouldn't run like that did. He's got some sort of accomplishment there.
From amateur radio station Alpha Charlie 4 Zulu Oscar, you've been listening to Inane Broadcast.
Yeah,
but I noticed then, your enthusiasm level for hamming and hamfesting rose rapidly as we proceeded through the flea market.
The hamfest energy is a very easy one to absorb and fall into. And, you know, you see ham stuff and, yep, you forget all about that movie.
Yeah, there was a lot of cool stuff. Thank you for carrying the tripod.
Oh, no problem. That's my pleasure.
You're young and spry and I'm old and feeble.
Yeah.
I'm not ready. Are you ready? Oh, I don't know what we're doing. Are we rolling?
Yeah. Oh, we are.
But I guess I'm not ready. I don't think you're ready. But we're going to do a show anyway. Ham Radio
Now.
So this
is like a Seat of the Britches show.
Ham Radio Now from Jeff's Workshop. That would be a good name for a show. You've wanted to do technical shows.
Yeah, but you don't want to do them because they're too much work.
It's not that I don't want to do them. It's just there's so many other things going on. And I would be happy to do them. We just have to figure out a way to squeeze them in. So we are going to do a highly technical show today. What is it?
We're going to make some antennas, some dipoles. We're going to make some dipoles.
Some simple dipoles.
We might put them up and try to make some contacts on it. As usual, I don't know exactly what we're doing, but what I can tell you is I've got some twin lead. I got some wire, some antenna wire.
And you got some
bones.
Some bones, yeah.
A couple of bones.
Don't you need three?
Well, I got a center.
Oh, one center thing.
Insulator. Okay. This is pretty fancy here. I've never tried something so fancy. We'll see how this does.
Looks like it's snarled on nothing. Ready, Gary?
I am ready.
Okay, now damp it and let go. Oh, right at the fence post, and it's inside. It's right at the fence post inside the fence. It's perfect. We don't even have to climb over the fence to get it.
Where the heck are you, Jeffy?
Hi, everybody. I'm in Duluth, Minnesota tonight.
Yeah, what are you doing up there?
I'm working in a paper mill. There's a paper mill that we've got some products in that are acting up, so I came up to take a look at them.
We have been getting a lot of email from people who have been commenting on the dipole program.
And so I haven't seen it yet, but did you mention in it that you shot like 4 hours and condensed it down to one?
A lot of witty repartee hit the cutting room floor.
Oh, yeah.
Never made it.
Well, see, that just goes to show you, people love to watch hams doing ham stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Than they love watching hams talking about doing ham stuff.
It would be better if we were good at promoting ham radio to the public for, you know, what it is, and not just make a sales pitch and overload people with information on how you can become one of us. But it's what we do. And that's particularly perilous with young people. The ones who have more than a passing interest will let you know, and you have to be available when they do.
I don't really want to do how-tos, because I know that would get the audience.
I'm trying to get him to, but
Jeff wants me to do how-tos.
He doesn't want to do it. I think hams like to see hams doing ham stuff.
Yeah.
He thinks hams like to see talking heads.
If I had all the resources and time that I would like to devote to this, you would be my YouTube star on how to do ham radio stuff.
Maybe I need to find a producer.
Well, meet Randy here.
So here is a ham that knows all the other hams in his DXCC entity. And we've talked to people in the bus line waiting for buses, and they haven't been waiting long, and we don't get to chat with them long. Always still in a good mood, even at the end of the day. The buses are not a problem. Yeah. But I wanted to know more about the volunteers. How do you recruit them? We've had a lot of trouble. Now, you said 400 to 500 volunteers to put on the hamvention.
The most radio clubs.
We use about 15% of that from a club with a membership of close to 300, and we have a lot of trouble with it. Do you recruit from outside groups or something?
Actually, we have a lot of people come to us. We'll have people from all over the United States and actually all over the world, and they'll come up and they'll say, you know, I'd like to volunteer. Can I volunteer to do something?
HamRadioNow, day two of the big trip to Seattle.
AC4ZO testing. Is this frequency in use, please?
The frequency is pretty quiet, KN4AQ.
Oh, hey, KN4AQ from AC4ZO.
Okay, there you go. Your signal is huge.
Yeah, yours too. You're about between S7 and S9.
Probably a little bit of QSB. Well, I'm on US 35, and if you remember where Gallipolis was.
Oh, okay, yeah. I get through Gallipolis about three times a year, once to Dayton, and usually about two other trips in that direction. So, well done. Here, I'm just pulling up the map now.
And hey, you're on television. Your voice is on television.
What's on television?
Your voice. I'm recording you. I've got the camera set up here pointing out the window. The microphone sitting at the speaker.
Oh, okay. Hello, everybody. Okay, so I've pulled the map here. We're about 735 IU between Gallipolis and Dayton.
Rocky Hill. 10 miles from Jackson, 63 miles from Chillicothe.
Okay, I see Chillicothe. I was too far up, but I see Rocky Hill now. That's good.
You are talking on that dipole we strung up over your house and made a television show out of, if I am not mistaken.
That's right. It's the only functional HF antenna here. The tri-bander I've let down the telescoping mast because I have some problems with it. So that dipole we made is the only HF antenna now. It's got to carry the day. And yep, that's what we're using. Thanks for the good signal report.
Greetings, radio amateurs. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 100. I should bang the table.
Yeah,
really,
should.
100. Well, big whoop.
Agreed.
Yeah, agreed.
How was my rush, by the way?
Very good.
I didn't like it.
There he is.
Look who I've got.
Oh. And me.
Look at that.
I have a friend, a non-ham friend, and you wouldn't believe what he told his daughters about prepping. Their question, it was a friend of mine from Orlando, and he's got these three daughters. I think their ages are 6 to 9 years old. And they asked him one time what those spheres along the power lines that you see on some of the high tension lines are for from time to time. And he told his daughters
they contain food.
astronaut food. That's what he told them. So in the case of, you know, the farmers, severe storms, and the farmers can't produce food or, you know, whatever kind of famine, you could get that food, but that they shouldn't tell anybody because there's not enough for everybody, and only the people that know about it will be able to get it.
Well, now you revealed it.
Mm. Well, they went and told their mother, hey, we know Daddy told us what those things on the power lines are for. And she said, oh, yeah, what are they for, baby? And they freaked out. Her eyes got real big, and they said, you don't know? And they just started screaming. And now this woman's got three hysterical children and doesn't know why.
Your camera's way over there.
There we are. Ah, that one. It's all this high-tech equipment.
Yep. 2007, the first program I did and produced the same year I shot it, the Dayton tour, with Jeff AC4ZO, the Dayton Virgin. Mm-hmm. And that's your initial inaugural appearance.
Yeah.
In those days, I wasn't appearing on camera so much. I did a little bit at the beginning, of the ARDF, and a little bit at the end. Mm-hmm. But mostly, I was in your Ken Burns silent, omniscient narrator. Not silent, but the
You were shooting hams doing ham stuff, which was your original calling.
So on that, you were my on camera guy. Yeah. You know, I showed up very little.
Looked really good too, huh?
Yeah. So and funny. We kid people. We have a good time. Mm-hmm. We're not serious. We do show new stuff.
Ham radio is serious stuff. I'm serious on the tour.
Yeah, you
watch one and you'll see.
These programs are not for the enthusiasts in their subject matter. Back me up on this, Jeff.
Well, see, again, you are so much more sophisticated than I am. I like Randy, and I like George, and I love what they're doing. And I watch shows that have subject matter that I know and that I'm interested in.
How do you learn about something that you don't know?
Well, you're starting to uncover the problem now, aren't you?
we're on the 101. The California episode.
I haven't been on that road in a long time.
We have to hurry because you have something to do today.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
It's the NASCAR race in Charlotte. Bobby and I are off to the NASCAR race. I had to wear my racing gear over here.
Racing gear. Is that a racing hat?
Well, it says Smith & Wesson on it, but the stripes, you know, make it a racing
stripe.
Hat.
Yeah. Do you have a racing stripe anywhere else I should know about?
Well, including the yellow one up my back.
This wasn't what I was thinking about, but we'll let the audience make up their own joke. You got fan mail from somebody. You got someone who asked you a question.
Yeah, it was his name was Rick, and I can't remember his call sign, but it was very flattering. He inquired about my accent, and he said, "Please don't be offended." And that's very flattering. It's not offensive at all. But what really bothers me about it is I didn't have anything exotic to tell him.
Well, you don't think you have an accent, or do you?
No. Well, I don't think anybody thinks they do. Themselves, you hear it in others. You don't hear it in yourself.
But you have a little bit of pattern of speech. Now you grew up. Yeah. You were born in Toledo.
Yeah, yeah.
So you should be as flat Midwestern as it comes.
Yeah, but I was like seven when we moved from there. Moved to Aberdeen Proving Grounds, Maryland, and grew up there.
So is that an accented place?
It's a slight southern accent, not a real heavy southern draw, just a little bit more southern than the Midwest accent. But I don't think that's where it came from. I was 19. I moved from there to North Carolina at 19 and then just started traveling everywhere for years after that with Mrs. Wittich. And I think this accent must have developed during those years of traveling.
When I first met you, I got a very distinct impression of a style of speech. I thought you sounded like Arlo Guthrie.
Oh, yeah, and I've heard that many times over the years.
So we're going to test now.
Okay.
To see if you sound like Arlo Guthrie.
This song is called Alice's Restaurant. It's about Alice and the restaurant.
Okay, that's probably enough for us to tell. Can you imitate that? what do you folks out there think?
Just in my normal speech.
In the flea market in our tour on Friday, you had your eye on something you were coveting.
Oh, yes, yes.
And I asked you if maybe you would, we asked how much it was, and it was expensive.
Yeah.
And I asked if you thought you might get it, and you were...
I couldn't buy it that day. I won't spend that kind of money the day I see something. I need at least a day to work on it before I make that decision.
Let's see if Kay knows what this is. Go ahead and pick it up.
I guess there's no secret now that I actually did end up with it. Okay.
Last year we brought out a wolf hong and asked if you knew what that was, and you knew what
and
that
you
was.
Did.
Yeah, that one I can nail. This one, I think I just lost the game of Stump the Band.
We're here on Antiques Roadshow.
Yes. Looks like a toilet flushing handle, doesn't it? In fact, the action is a bit like one too, but the inside kind of gives it away.
Yeah, sort of a side swiper kind of a thing.
Yeah,
she nailed it.
It is a telegraph key. Yeah.
You get to keep your technician license.
And oh, gee, thanks.
Santa.
It is the season.
I understand it does tricks.
It does tricks?
Yes.
You've been talking to Bobby.
Yeah.
She likes this one.
Is it resonant on any particular frequency?
3 hertz, maybe. They can be aligned vertically like that. They can be, and I've never seen anybody do that. You always see them aligned horizontally, but they can be two orientations, one like this.
You got to watch your monitor because you're getting out of camera range here. You're limited.
One like this. Well, let me just put another pair together, the other orientation.
Okay.
And you can see what happens when you try to mate them. Now, these are genderless connectors. You know what I mean by genderless?
You can have them on either end of the wire, and it doesn't matter. You don't have male. Yeah. You don't have female. They will connect together in any configuration.
So. Yeah. I thought they were called genderless because connectors are named after their inventor, and these were invented by Fred Genderless.
You got that, exactly.
Okay.
So show what the problem is.
When we have them like this, and you connect them... You see the problem immediately. We got red to black and black to red. Can't have that. Just by swapping one pair, like so. There we go.
It should be easy to do. It's not really
they're just,
easy to
they're
do.
A little fiddly. Now, when you connect them up, you can see what you get.
Not the last, but close to the last episode of Last Man Standing.
Yeah.
Last season.
Yeah, I remember.
Last spring. He doesn't get on the air, but his daughter does.
Yeah, Mandy.
Yep. And and people bitched and moaned and whined and complained.
We saw ham radio on primetime sitcom. What could be better than that?
And then they started telling us on Ham Nation that the episode of Thanksgiving was going to have ham radio in it again.
Did you see it?
Oh, yes.
Mike, KA0XTT. Ham radio is heavily regulated by the FCC.
Okay, well.
He's not complaining about the weight with which ham radio is regulated. He's comparing it to other services that have what he considers less favorable programming.
Same people who censor network television but not cable, so drug dealers and murderers become our heroes.
I believe you like watching violent television.
Violent movies. Television?
You like seeing things blow up.
I like things blowing up.
Yeah. I like things blowing up, too.
They censor, but they regulate my ham radio. They require me to have a license, test, and if they don't like what I have to say, they can fine me or lock me up.
That content is probably a direct reflection on the complaints from last summer's show.
You're an OO, aren't you?
Yeah.
Are you an active OO? Have you sent out anything in a while?
No, I'm trying to remember the last notice I sent out. I can't remember now what it was.
Been a while.
Yeah, we get information from the coordinator from time to time asking us to listen to a particular frequency or for a particular station. And
yeah.
Mostly that's the extent of my activity.
Did you get tired of people just going off on you for some
reason? Oh, do they ever. And our own Cliff was probably the worst.
What did he do?
I sent him a notice. Well, it was there was a simulated emergency test, and the word came from the net control station that you didn't have to use call signs because we were using tactical identifiers, and I called him on the phone and said, you do have to, you know, you still have to be legal. It's a drill, and you have to be legal. You have to use those call signs as prescribed. You can use tactical identifiers as well, but he never did anything about it. So no call signs came over for about 2 hours, so every operator got an OO notice pointing to the rules concerning identification.
Yep. Tactical call signs are a really good idea.
Yeah, they are, but they don't fulfill the law.
What a great way to treat the last line of communication during the coming apocalypse.
Oh, that is going to attract some attention.
I liked it.
So this Thanksgiving, while the rest of you are enjoying your turkey, I'm savoring my ham.
Oh.
Happy Thanksgiving, FCC, because I know you're listening.
So, I mean, man.
I think it's funny.
Ham Radio Now, episode... Uh-oh. Hang on, I gotta look at this. Oh, no, I didn't want to look at that. That's your ugly face.
Hi, Gary.
You're here on Skype because you're at work, right?
Yeah, I'm at work.
I've got you goofing off to do a bit of a show here.
You just seem to have caught me in the middle of nothing.
Yeah, you know, let's make you full screen. There you go.
Doggone, I look good.
let me just play a little bit of it for the audience.
From the leading edge of new discoveries to the front lines of disasters, from family safety and security to the limits of exploration on this planet and of other worlds, and to virtually every part of our daily lives, radio communications continues to find new ways to make the impossible possible.
So you watched a little bit of it. What did you think initially?
Well, presumably, since the title is Discovering Amateur Radio, this is aimed at non-hams trying to attract them to amateur radio. And if I was a non-ham, I would have to be a serious overachiever for this video to do anything at all for me. The reason is, it shows ham radio in very grand terms. You know, I don't want to, if I was an aspiring ham, I'd be scared to death of disaster relief and, you know, everything they showed was concerning space and really huge stuff. Nothing, you know, expensive radios. The radios that I saw on there were just top of the line, really high dollar stuff. And it didn't show enough hams doing ham stuff like everyday hams do. You know, most of the stuff I saw in the first, that clip there, plus the 15 minutes that I watched earlier, are things that most hams don't do. Some do, but it's not what most hams do.
I have probably dragged you away from work long enough.
Yeah, I'm really itching to get back to it. Bye, everybody.
All right. We'll see you later, Jeff.
Okay.
So this episode is my stupid plan for 60 meters. So
we already have 60 meters.
This is the TX Factor, and I'm Bob McCready, G0FGX.
I thought it was easier to watch, just more enjoyable. I like the fact that they introduced their three segments that's going to be on the show, you know, and themselves.
We sort of did. Sort of coming and going, halting and misdirecting ourselves. And then eventually we got around to talking about what we were going to talk about.
Yes, I like their way better.
And I have a special treat for you guys. Sitting right here in the Ham Radio Now studio is my buddy Jeff, AC4ZO. Say hi to everybody, Jeff.
Hi, everybody. Happy to be here.
Oh, you're getting the clap.
That's much more than it deserves.
You're getting the golf clap.
Oh, no.
This is the hardest video conference I have ever set up. This is Jeff.
Well, it's just a video conferencing circuit, and it works through a real low width, so it'll work from a hotel. I'm in a hotel in Chicago tonight.
Another episode where you don't know what we're doing.
Okay.
Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Through the auspices of Arvin, our mascot back there, at hamradionow.tv. If you enjoy these programs, Jeff, do you enjoy these programs?
Oh, I do. I've seen some.
You've seen one or two. We're at 179.
No, I've seen half a dozen or more.
Wow.
And I've heard more than that, just going to Dayton and back.
All the way through?
Yeah, yeah.
To the very end?
Well, the ones we go to Dayton and back, yeah.
Because I play them in the car.
Yeah.
Gary said I could do Jeff's telegraphy moment here at Dayton, so I want to show you a couple of the unusual telegraph keys we found here at the Hamvention.
This is Jeff's Telegraphy Corner, Name That Tune Edition. Okay, what did they send, first of all?
I don't know.
But it
was, I'm trying to think of the name of the tunes. Something racial was from a video game. The first Morse code I ever heard just in the wild was in a video game called Castle Wolfenstein. The message didn't make sense, though. It was real text in English, but it didn't have anything to do with the game.
The review said that the movie was short on plot and long on action. And our reaction was,
That's what they want to see. That's why I don't go when you all go to movies.
Yeah. Jeff knows how to use He knows how to use a slide rule.
Oh, yeah.
That's impressive.
I should have brought one with me.
Darn.
And I don't use that for practical purposes anymore. I only use the slide rule if I'm showing off.
You aren't in the Target looking at how much toilet paper is by the roll with your slide rule.
You could calculate. Well, this could go down the hill. It's not Friday night now.
Okay. Okay. I'll be quiet.
So where do we start?
On the internet. This is episode 335. Fix it. Fix it. Here are a pair of co-hosts. I am surrounded by co-hosts. We're going to talk about fixing that radio, but we're also going to talk about general troubleshooting and repair kind of stuff, which is what you do all day, every day. but not in ham radio.
No.
Sadly.
No. No. I would like to, but hams don't want to pay a lot for that. Well, my boss doesn't pay a lot either.
Right? Well, I'm not going to pay a lot for this technician.
And this, I would barely call it an optical encoder. It's a single bit encoder.
Well, no detail yet. Just very. You know, we're
stringing them along,
working our way.
Okay.
Dancing around the issue a little bit. Astute viewers of the program will notice that I did not fix it. That guy over there fixed it.
we did our best to spot exactly where they were. We did them one at a time. And what we discovered is with one of them, when we rotated it one direction, we didn't have to go very far before the radio quit working. The other direction, we could go a good 40 or 50 degrees before it stopped working. So it was right near the edge of the threshold. So we put it a little more into the working range by a little more. I'm saying, you know, between 5 and 10 degrees. Okay. And the other potentiometer did exactly the same thing. There was a range over which it worked. Its position it was very, very close to the edge of that range. So we brought it into the range 15%.
Yep. Because what the heck?
Yeah.
And the show is, can I do that? Totaled.
We are in the path of totality now. We're still about 31 miles from the center of the path, but we're at least in the path.
Okay, so that's why it's so dark, right?
Yeah, that's why it's dark. No, it's dark because we're still a couple hours from sunrise, I think.
Now, at this point, you can still only look at it with the eclipse glasses. Jeff kept telling everybody to stay indoors.
I did not.
70 miles, roughly.
Quit that.
Below 1,000 lux now.
Yeah.
Okay, so I opened the exposure to automatic now.
It's attacking.
So now the camera makes it look much brighter than it really was.
There it goes.
But you'll still see it get darker.
Yeah, the shadows disappear at totality.
And look at the horizon. Look at the orange horizon up here.
There we go.
It's gone. It is gone. Oh, wow. Oh.
Now you understand.
Cannot be prepared for this. You cannot.
You can't even see with the glasses on anymore. That is so.
Oh, my God.
I'm actually kind of proud of that reaction.
Okay, let me show you. This I think I can show you.
Oh, wow. Look at that.
It gets better.
All the way down.
You can see a star to the lower left.
Yeah, but that's what it looked like as we were all watching. It was that dark. Yeah, so this is...
Yeah, that star was Regulus, it turned out. Brightest star in Leo.
Here comes the diamond ring. Can't look anymore.
Yeah, that was the thing that surprised me. As soon as that burst of light came, you had to put your glasses back on again.
Wow, look at that. That is so cool.
All those people that were told to watch it on TV sure got shortchanged.
2024. Nope.
That was so cool.
Yeah. And now, I'm going to the Midwest. I just decided to go into the next one.
Yeah, we're 5 minutes past totality now, 4 or 5 minutes. And it's really something.
More of a deal.
They're leaving from down there. I can see them leaving.
People leaving already.
Yeah. It has a funny deal.
All right. The lux is back up to about 7,000. I say it dropped to below 1,000. It was pretty neat. We've been watching the lux, the brightness from the sun. It was over 120,000 when we first started, and it was into the eclipse when we started looking.
I mean, it's just on your phone, right?
Yeah, it's just there's an app on the phone that can show it. Let me see. It's that one that's reading about 1,500, but if I tilt it towards the sun, it'll shoot on up there. Oh, 77,000 some, 75, 76. It was really strange when the actual sunlight was 1% of what it normally is. I mean, there's shadows, and they're not really long shadows like at night, just shadows, but it's not bright out.
I've heard a total eclipse described as nature's greatest show, and let there be no doubt, it really is, and you know, there's more difference between 99% and 100% than there is between a 10% eclipse and a 99% eclipse. That last bit really does make a difference. The thing that was most striking to me was the diamond ring. You know, there's a lot of hype about it, a lot of photos online and in magazines about it, and you know, it's coming out of eclipse, yeah, you can still see the corona and a bit of the surface of the sun. It wasn't that big a deal in the photos, but the photos don't capture just how brilliant that spot is. You know, the human eye has a dynamic range somewhere in the neighborhood of 6 decades, and a camera has a range of maybe 2.5, 3 at the most.
And I guess that's why the photos just don't show the brilliance of that.
Yeah, you know, that's what hit me is it started to move away and that diamond appeared.
Yeah.
It was like this instantaneous laser beam just being thrown right at you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They say you got 5 seconds to look at it.
I didn't have that long.
I looked about two.
I couldn't. As soon as it appeared, I had to put my glasses back on. It was so bright.
I think that was Bobby's favorite part, too.
For Ham Radio Now, I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
And I'm Jeff Wittich, AC4ZO.
Over.
And out.
Over. And out.
Over. Over.
And out.
And out.
Yeah.
And over.
We mess that out.
And out.
You want to do it again? Let's not.
Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. Over.
And out.
Let's get the heck out of here. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Jeff Wittich, AC4ZO.
Over.
And out.
I'm KD4ACW.
I'm Jeff, AC4ZO.
Over.
And
out.
Whoops, screwed it up.
I'm still Jeff Wittich, AC4ZO. Over.
And out.